let's go back to my risk and safety guy. Okay, so I'm gonna go through a risk and safety analysis. Somebody's gonna say, well, we did our RPNs, did that catch it? Not really, that didn't. When it comes to risk and safety, even though we think that a classical FME activity will catch a lot of them, the answer is not going to. Okay, so even though I put in those, I wanna go and do a more in-depth risk and safety analysis on that. Now, if I took the information that's already there in the FMEA, what can I do with that? Well, let's go take a look at what I had there. So basically, I had four FMEAs. And this is where the difference now is going to come up. Each one of those FMEAs that I do on an item is not a standalone item. I want to merge them all together. So from a whole system perspective, I've got an FMEA for the frame. I've got one for the wiring. I've got one for the bulb. And I've got one for the socket. Now, if I go through that and look at the effects of each cause or of each failure mode that's out there, one of the things I may find out is that there are effects that, as a safety guy, would consider undesirable. Okay, so one of those events in there is a fire. What's the probability of fire? What is the actual probability of that occurring? Okay, now how would you find that? Well, for me to figure out what that is, I could take your FMEAs now, go through all of them for the entire system, look at all of your effects, identify where the fire effect lies, find out what causes related with that. Okay, for each one of those causes, you did give me a probability of occurrence, right? Then take that probability of occurrence and then combine all of those together into the probability of the event happening. Now, if I've got everything in a relational system, you know how long it takes to do that? Milliseconds. You just push the right button, you say, hey, sort out. So I can go through and say, okay, look at my thermal event, look at my fire, and go ahead and pick those causes. And then one way to do that is work it backwards, looking at all the FMEAs for the entire system, and go ahead and construct a fault tree leading to the fire event. Again, traditional activities we do today. I'm not doing anything different. I'm taking the FMEA, and I'm basically generating fault trees by event, by effect, that I'm concerned as a risk and safety guy. Now, again, as a risk and safety guy, I have to rely on that original document. So I don't have to do any of the work to go ahead and figure out what that is, because you've already done it when you did that FMEA, right? My probability of fire is 1.7%. As, of course, the risk and safety guy would not be a very, very happy person with that number. Keep in mind that that number may or may not be anywhere close to reality. At this point, that number is based on, if I had no other data, it is based on what the inputs were from the FMEA team. Is that useful? Heck yeah, if you guys think this is gonna be this high, then we better do something about it. So again, even if it's not gonna be realistic, it is gonna drive you to go back and look at everything, and perhaps you start adding additional action items to go ahead and eliminate that. But what I did was pretty easy, is now I can go ahead and say, hey, I've got a probability of a cause. I go through my FMEAs, I can slice and dice it and put it this way. Again, this is what I said, I can look at it in many different ways. So a lot of your searches on trying to find things are based on what your text entry was. So if you describe fire as a thermal event and you only type fire, then it won't find thermal events. Now, if you say fire or thermal events, you'll find both of those. So it's a search, okay? And once I find those, I got to drive down to the causes and then ask the question, have we done anything to eliminate these causes? So in this case, keep in mind that I could take that analysis now. Okay, let's make that an object. Let's go encapsulate all of that risk and safety analysis I just did and put it into a box. I can fit it into another diagram. Let's say that's my probability of fire. And then I can start putting a logic tree together or a consequence tree or a diagram where it says, well, what are the outcomes of a fire? That's something the risk and safety guy may want to do, right? Okay, so is a fire going to injure somebody? Not always. It could do nothing because somebody saw it and put it away. It could create a lot of water damage. It could burn down the house. So I can start playing with what are the different outcomes. If the fire alarm goes off, fire department shows up, response in time, sprinkler gets activated, or they dump a lot of water, chances are you're not going to hurt anybody and you're going to get water damage. So what I would do is this now is inherited from my fault tree, which is inherited from my FMEA, and this may be new models now that describe all of those events. But at the end of the day, what I'm doing is coming up with different outcomes as I go through it from a risk and safety perspective. And once I've done that, maybe I find out that, hey, what's happened is even though it's 2%, you know, burning the house down is this low, injuries is this low, no damage is there. That's how much water damage we're gonna cause. Then I can put dollars on that. I took the existing DFMEA for the whole chandelier, automatically extracted causes that will lead to an effect of interest, whatever effect I was looking at a study. Automatically constructed a fault tree, used the occurrence probabilities from the FMEA at this point, or what the FMEA team told me. Now, important aside, these values may have nothing to do with reality at this point, I don't know, but it's a starting point. Then I took all of that, ended up going into Reno and built pretty much an event analysis that kind of told me how things would split out. Now, here's the issue. What's my source data? Everything I do, I look at my source data. In this case, my source data came out of the team that did this. Okay, they picked a two, they picked a three. Whether they picked a two or a three, there was a number associated with it. That's the number I used. Are those numbers right? May or may not be. Okay, what I'd want to do if I'm the risk and safety guy now is I'd want to go back and audit this from a risk and safety perspective. And this is where I said, you're not going to catch everything through an RPN or criticality. I'm going to now go through and reorder everything from a risk and safety perspective. Because I'm going to totally give you a whole different hierarchy of what's really important from a risk and safety perspective, where it could be a very, very small number of 0.0001 that would not show up in the other analysis. But if I'm a risk and safety guy, they have a different importance, right? So what I'd want to do is go back, look at the source. Now, for causes that are driving the numbers that I'm looking at, I would go back and sit down the whole team and say, hey, where did you guys come up with this? Does this make sense? If it doesn't make sense. You know, you gave me an occurrence of three, which means one in 100,000. Is it really one in 100,000? If it's really one in 100,000 and it's critical driver to your safety, then what do? I start adding additional action items there to make sure I mitigate that. Okay, so do I have data? Can I replace that with a real model? If I don't have that, can I get an expert? Can I get expert opinions? Is there somebody that knows better? Physics of failure. I can start going through those to understand it. None of those are there. You know what? It's important enough. I want to set up a test for it. I need to understand this better. Maybe I want to set up an accelerator test or whatever test I need to set up later on. As you're doing that, you're also now adding your plans into tests you need to do later. Some of these tests may be things that you don't know now, but you need to find out once you start getting a system or a prototype together. So you're also doing some of your test planning. Now, if I've got a real system that is getting data, warranty system, practice system, I mean, I could go in there and start pulling that data and linking it to what those occurrences are. So in this particular case, let's say I've got a certain item and that's a specific failure mode, then I've got warranty data and it could be practice data. I could go in and pull it. If I got it in a system that I'm connected to, I can go in and pull that information, slice and dice it any way I want to, build models from that if I wish. So now I'm going to basically sort out what are the failure modes in the chandelier that I have in my warranty database or fragas database by different failure modes. Based on those, I could, again, as I said, slice and dice them and look at what are the things that are important. And once I've done that, extract whatever data I need, and I can now start build a model for me. Or go back and validate where did this come from as a source. And again, along those lines, once I've extracted it, I can now build a model, and I can go back associated with that occurrence, right? The minute I've associated a new model with that occurrence, everything got updated. So his risk is hopefully is no longer 1.7%. All of his analysis just changed to reflect whatever I just changed. So what I just did in this case, I basically went through the procedural DFMEA, basically created a model of that where I could actually get numbers to kind of look at this in different ways. So once I've got these numbers here, I did some analysis. Maybe then I went back, I got real data, went up here, built a model, put that model back in there, updated that analysis. You kind of see how everything gets connected now. If I've done everything and I've got the risk and safety guy did everything to this point, I could ask you another question, right? Let's say I can't change this. This is what it is. It's 1.7%. Okay, and if I can't change that, I could put controls in place to make sure it doesn't happen. In this case, my controls would be the fire alarm and whatever else I have here, right? So a question could be, what should the values of those controls be in order to minimize my injury probability? Okay, this is where I'm gonna, again, take another activity and another tool that we do today as reliability guys. Okay, I could go through a DOE on that right now and tell you which ones of those are significant. And I can tell you what those values should be in order to minimize a specific effect. So let me do that. And in DOE terms, what's my response? My response is injury probability, right? That's what I want to minimize. What are my factors? My factors are, did the customer notice it? Or did the alarm get activated? Or did the sprinkler get activated? Or did the fire department respond and respond in time? Those are all factors, right, that influence the injury outcome based on that diagram. So now I've set up a structured DOE. That's a designed experiment. Now, once I've done that, I can generate a DOE on that by setting different values for the factors and looking at what the outcome is. Now, in a traditional sense, the way you do DOE, you go through that and then you go perform the experiment and you get the response. In this case, I can virtually do all of it because my response is going to come out of my system, right? So if I'm going to automatically generate responses, I really don't care how complicated I make the DOE, so I'm going to do a full factorial. Full factorial meaning I'm going to look at every combination. So I might have 7,000 responses, I have to do 7,000 experiments, but who cares? Virtually, I can do them in seconds, right? So let's go back, and I'm going to generate a designed experiment. I'm back in our DOE now, which understands everything else that's already in synthesis. So it's going to go generate an experiment with lots and lots of columns. And once it generates that, I'm going to go back into Reno and say, hey, grab that DOE experiment you just did and rerun it by changing every single variable, every single factor that's in there, to correspond to this experiment. So now I'm going to virtually go back and recompute responses for each one of those settings. So what I'm going to really do is do a virtual DOE over whatever I've got in there that goes all the way back to the original FMEA. Now, once I've done that, a couple of neat things happen. I've got my DOE, I've got my responses. So once I've got my responses, I can start doing analysis. One of the analyses I may want to look at is what's important, what's significant out of all those factors. There may be noise, and there may be factors that matter. In this particular case, once I go through that, I'm going to find out that alarm activated is a significant factor. The sprinkler going off is a significant factor based on what I had over there. That's how I avoid injuries. Fire department responding is irrelevant. Basically, I'm going to injure someone, I'm going to injure in the first 3 minutes. If a fire alarm doesn't go off, sprinkler doesn't go off, the rest of those variables are really not going to affect what ends up happening on the injury variable. Whereas the fire department response time would be significant if you're looking at a burned down house, but not necessarily the injury. So it gives me a way to kind of recategorize everything and come up with another list as to what factors are important and so forth. Once I figured out what that is, I could also do optimal solutions. I could say what those factors should be, minimize, let's say, my injury probability, then what should those control values be in order for me to minimize that? And again, that's standard DOE methodologies, but I can set each one of those values at a target level that where I need them to be in order for me to reach my minimum. So in this case, yeah, I've got alarm activated, those being important, B and C being important, then I can look at, hey, those values need to be set there if you want basically 1 in 3 million as your probability. Just doing things backwards. Let's look at the whole thing now from a reliability perspective. The same data, I could look at it from different views and I would catch different things that I need to do depending, again, what my point of view is. If I'm going to look at it from a risk and safety, I'm going to catch the things that are important from a risk and safety perspective. Okay? I'm not going to look at things that are important from a reliability perspective, and what the view of the risk and safety guys and the reliability guys is not always the same. Now, in the case of reliability, let's go to this. Let's say I've got 4 lights sitting out there. This particular system, or that bulb, fails every day. Now, if I go through my traditional RPN type of analysis, hey, what's the occurrence? Well, let's give it a 10. Happens every day, right? Detectability? Hey, look up and look at it. It's not on. Severity? Who cares? There's another 3 lights right next to it, right? Where is that going to fall in that hierarchy? Down at the bottom? If I'm the risk and safety guy, and I did everything from a risk and safety perspective using the fault tree idea I gave you, where is that going to fall at? Down at the bottom. But what if I told you for me to go change that bulb? I got to get a crew out there every day and a crane to do that. And that's lots and lots of money. Do I care about that from a reliability perspective? Heck yeah. So to me, that's huge. Whereas all the other two pieces are going to miss it. Because again, it's not important from their point of view. And this is really what we got to step at. We've all got different points of view that we're looking at it. So if we've got it, if we can look at it from all the perspectives, all the points of view, we're more likely to catch everything. What my fMRA is going to do is look at things from the perspective of a reliability perspective. I'm not looking at it from safety. It's basically, is this going to fail and how much is it going to cost me? So now what I want to do is go do the same thing. Once my risk and safety guy went through everything, or in parallel, I'm going to go look at this from a reliability perspective and again reassess what's important on that list and add additional action items. What I'm going to go ahead and call this an fMRA, and really just to kind of separate from the FMEA, because I'm going to start basically using the same source data, but just look at it differently. So I'm going to look at it from a reliability perspective. I can go ahead and take the existing FMEA or what's in there. Is there anything wrong with me saying, okay, I've got a bulb and a socket. The component's a bulb. That's the causes of how it will fail. I know what the probability of occurrence of this cause is. Then by default, I know what the probability of occurrence of the failure of the bulb is. Up there, everything's in series, right? Reliability 101. So I could actually take all of those numbers and give you a reliability value. So I could go through that and say, okay, these are the causes. That cause goes into the component goes into the system. If I know what these values are, I can drive it up. Again, using all the information that's there, I'm not recreating anything. Okay, so I'm now viewing the information differently. So one way I would do that, I could just go, let's say my FMEA said recast it, let's view it in another format. And the way I would view it in another format is basically show it differently, where now I'm gonna show the causes as numbers, put on reliabilities. One way I could do that is color-coded, make it management friendly. That way I kind of see what sticks out, what doesn't stick out. This scenario assumes everything's in series. If it was more complex than that, I can go add a lot of complexity on top of that. So that's one approach. But really what that would do, in a way, is kind of give me a baseline reliability, right? Now, same argument that I did on the safety side. What is the data that's driving this number? It's whatever those guys that sat in the room gave me as a number. That may or may not be the true value, right? But at least is what you think it is at this point. Again, we have nothing. So I want to make sure, kind of recast that information and say, you know what? That's what you're telling me it is. So let's go ahead and take what I've got in there, and I'm going to look at it as an RBD. Same information, going down to the causes themselves basically drive what's up there. If I go through that, I'll find out that based on whatever inputs I put in there on the original, the FMEA, I end up with a reliability of 84%. Now, what was my target? 95, okay, so I'm off. Okay. Now, again, it's my reliability, but what does it really mean? It's really the opinion of the people. I put the DFMEA together. I mean, at the end, that's what it is. Is that a value? Well, yes. In a way, you're telling me that you don't think you have the target reliability already, right? So if you're telling me you don't have it already, what do you need to do? You need to do something to get there. What I want to do is make sure I get that number to be where I want to be. How do I do that? Is I add additional action items. I go back and re-audit everything like the safety guy did, and start changing things and adding actions to bring that higher. So by the end of the day, if I've added enough actions, I should bring that number up. So I'd go through now, and again, if I have all the information, I can go blocks and say, you know what, grab that FMEA, build everything for me. I can do that in seconds, because again, I got the information in a way that I can use it any way I want to. So now I've got an RBD, let's say, down to the causes themselves. Again, if I'm the reliability guy doing this, there is no extra work I need to be doing because I'm basically leveraging all the work that somebody else did before me. I can in seconds build that if I have the original document. And again, I have values in them that are based on what's the best information I had at that time. So again, here I'd get the same answer. And as I said, that's not good enough. So what's next? Well, what's next is I start out here with a baseline and I want to get over here. Then I need to find out how do I get from there to there, right? So as I go through that, I need to find out what items I need to change. Where do I need to put action items at? What are the things that I'm concerned about that I need to improve in order to get there? Now, again, as I'm moving forward, you're gonna kind of realize that I'm getting a hub and spoke connection. In the middle, I got what I'm gonna call my FMEA, right? And really, to me, again, you don't wanna call it that, call it something else. What I want is system, assembly, part, failure mode, consequences, consequences. I need that list. And I'm gonna keep working with that master list as I go forward. My master list gets constantly updated, specifically failure modes, consequences. Those are gonna get constantly updated as I move forward. I'm gonna stick that in the center. I'm gonna use all my other activities to basically fit information into that. So in this case, as an example, I got the lamp, filament burn, no light. I can use, let's say, Weibull analysis, get an object from here, associate it back into here. The Weibull analysis here is more of a spoke activity. So as I go from those, let's move forward. Talk about reliability allocation, look at sensitivity analysis, and what items I want to look at. A lot of what I'm going to do here is, again, based on traditional things we do in reliability engineering. But as I go through this list, I want to find out, you know, what are those things that I need to worry about, right? You know, what are those causes that are driving that? So one of the things I could do is I could take your entire FMEA that you put it together, or whatever that list stands at the moment, and go through some type of sensitivity analysis and try to figure out, you know, what are these things that I need to go after? And now keep in mind, I mean, when you're looking at my chandelier, it's only got like 20 items, right? Well, imagine having a turbofan engine. Okay, you got thousands of them in there. So you need a structured process to be able to kind of figure out, you know, where those needles are at, especially if something's considerably large. Okay, so let's go forward. Two ways to do it. I'm gonna use, I can look at importance analysis. Fred diagrams basically is our version of, it's a visualization of importance analysis. Basically is what I call management friendly views of importance analysis. Let me kind of show you those really quick, but just to kind of show you, I can show you some more complex, because everything I'm doing until now is in series. There's no reason I couldn't put things in a more complex configuration. So for example, if I had like a communication system, in this case, it's not my chandelier, and I wanted to know what's important in there, one of the things I could do is go through that and come up with a system reliability equation for the system. It's not a fun exercise to go and do by hand. But, and a lot of us don't do this, but you got computers. I mean, I can get a computer and I can give me 10 million terms, reliability terms, combined together in seconds, so why not use it? Okay, so if I can get this, one of the things that I would do is go through and then for each cause, because really that's my lowest level in this case, for each cause, go ahead and take a metric which is gonna be the derivative of the system reliability equation with respect to the reliability or probability of occurrence of that cause, right? Now, what's a derivative? Forget, put the math away, but a derivative is nothing more than a rate, right? So what that gives me is the rate of increase of the system's reliability with respect to the rate of increase of that component's reliability. Okay, so I can use that to kind of see what's important. So I could go through and then start identifying critical components. In this case, the critical components are the failure modes and causes, because that's really my lowest level component in my RBD. The easy way to show that is basically kind of redraw it in a tree like this, instead of giving derivatives and equations, and this is what I call the management-friendly view. So what I would do for the chandelier is basically on the background, create a whole equation for your whole system, go through each one of those computer number, and then present it in this particular view. So basically, what does this tell me? Red's bad. So I start looking at things that are sticking out as I go through that from a system level. If I do this for my chandelier, I would go through that now and say, okay, take that. I've got the whole system as it was made, as I brought it in there. Okay, let's build a diagram from the top down. Take those importance values at a given time. I can set my color limits to what I want them to be. So based on what color limits I set up, I can actually give you a static picture of what's kind of driving it all the way down to the causes, right? Let's go ahead and look at it this way. So I've got the chandelier, I've got frame, wiring, bulb and socket, I've got my bulb and my socket, then I keep on going down to the causes. If I do that, I'll find out my bulb and socket subsystems are red, and I can go down to the lowest level of what's red, and I find out there is three causes in there, And again, depends on what filtering level I set it at. But at the bottom, there is three causes that are driving that reliability value. So I go look at each one of those. The first one that comes in, it says, cap fails to screw in all the way. Okay, so I've got a failure mode where the customer doesn't know how to screw in a light bulb. Some of the questions you go through from a reliability perspective now, does that make sense? And what number did you put in there? You're telling me that 10% of the customers can't screw in a light bulb? And if that's the case, that 10% of the customers don't know how to screw in a light bulb, maybe we need a design change where let's put a line on the bulb, put a line on the socket, you know, ship instruction that says, you know, they must line up, and maybe we make it 5% of the people don't know how to screw in a light bulb. So I put an action item in there to make a design change to either lower that probability of occurrence or eliminate it. Then the next one I run into goes to here, it says, well, filament burns. Yeah, you got an incandescent bulb sitting in there. Yeah, probably that's going to come out as an issue that your filament's going to burn. Now, in that particular case, again, you could say, well, we don't know if that number's right. And then it could be, well, let's go test a bunch of bulbs. So this becomes an action item to go do a test on the bulbs. Or, again, change the design. So I would go through each one of what's red over here and try to look at them and say either is it correct? It's a driver. If it is correct, then can we change it, or do we need to learn more? That becomes your exercise. Or I may get up here and say, well, there's another one that's red, which means it's an important driver. Well, it's presence of foreign conductive material inside the socket. And that's another one that came out of the original FMEA. Well, you can look at how would that happen. Well, is that really, I mean, the customer isn't going to do it. So it's more of a manufacturing, perhaps, concern. So then here, what I want to do is ask the question, why is that happening? And if so, how do we eliminate it? So maybe let's say, well, you know what, that shouldn't be there. We can address it in the manufacturing process. We'll make sure that doesn't happen. Now, what I need to do is take that concern and transfer it over to manufacturing. Okay, so parking lot that for a second, I'll come back to that. Okay. Now, at the same time, as I go through that, I could be changing what that initial model was, right? So I'm getting it better, all my numbers are changing. As I keep going through this, what happens with reds and greens is what happens if you take the bottom three out, three more that are going to come up, right? Especially if you use an absolute scale. So it kind of gives you what the worst up as you move up the scale, and what you want to be doing is addressing those with additional action items until you end up coming up with a number at the end, instead of that 85%, something that's much higher than what your target is. There's a lot of discussion that's going on here. You know, if things are in there that are driving it, I go back and we're all going to ask questions. Do I need to learn more? Is it a mistake? What's why? So as I keep on asking those, I'm again updating what I've got in the back. And this is where I said at the end, you're doing it better. Because now you've got everybody looking at the same thing. My safety guy is changing it. My reliability guy is changing it. Design is in there. We're all looking at the same central list. We're updating the central list, and we're not out there on our own little silo doing whatever we need to do just to make our piece of the pie better. So what I need to be doing is create additional actions to address driving changes. I would add or assign those actions back to my plan. I would update my FMEA with any new actions. As I get better results through these actions, I would update all related analysis. I would go back to the source and change it. So I'll re-examine new results, including prior risk analysis. At the same time, I could be changing what the risk and safety guys see. So I got to make sure, again, I'm looking at it from that view. Hopefully, I'm making these numbers better if I'm improving reliability. And again, those two things don't have to be related. What's important to the risk and safety guy is not necessarily what's important to the reliability guy. I could do more fun things. I can get into cost analysis at this point. I could go down to each one of those causes, if I don't want to go through this, to the importance analysis and work it backwards through a cost allocation and tell you what all the occurrences should be in your FMEA in order for you to reach your target. And then go re-examine them this way. So again, I'm going round and round in circles. So I could go back and put some cost equation in there. I'll run through it, and I could come up and tell you, you know what, only you're saying 5% of the customers don't know how to screw in a bulb. You know, you have to make it such that only 2 out of 100 don't know how to screw in a bulb. Make sense? And I can work it backwards. So again, I can do that and compare where are you at and where do we need to be. Let's assume now that as I'm going through that, you know, our MBAs, guys that make the big bucks in the chandelier company, just decided that, you know, making an incandescent chandelier isn't going to really, it's not the best business choice. So now we just decided we need to move over to a LED chandelier.
that's got some dimming capabilities. So all of a sudden now we got to go to this new design, even though we got to this point. Of course, they're going to keep making the other one too, because in their mind, it's good to throw good money after bad. So we need to keep both designs there. Okay. So now if I'm going to go over and divert to this design, now I got to go over to an LED chandelier. Some of the things I could do from a reliability side, if I've got all of the work I've done to this point, you know, I could take that reliability system hierarchy I have over here, delete the light bulb out of there, the incandescent bulb, and I'll go ahead and add an integrated dimming LED controller as well as a new LED light in the same hierarchy. Now, I could go through my change point analysis, and this is where the change point analysis would come in, and I will go through the frame, wiring, and socket and say, by me removing the incandescent bulb and putting in an LED bulb with a controller, does that really affect, from a reliability perspective, any of the other systems? Okay, is there a change? You know, maybe one of my concerns would be heat loads, but guess what? With LED, I'm gonna have a lot less of a heat load than I have with an incandescent bulb. Okay, so perhaps I find out after I do that change point analysis that nothing needs to change on those items. So then guess what? I'm gonna keep the same analysis I have there. Then the two new items that come in, I got the LED controller and I've got the bulb. I may also decide that I may not wanna go through and look at every failure mode, and those are engineering decisions. You're gonna kind of study them. But I might just say, you know what? The LED controller, I'm gonna buy that from somebody that makes them. Okay, so I'll get that controller from somebody and I'm just gonna stick it in there as an off-the-shelf item. Maybe I may wanna do some reliability analysis at that level, but I'm not gonna go all the way down and do a full analysis on the components that are inside of that. That's an option. Same thing with the bulb. I'm gonna go buy a commercial off-the-shelf LED light. I just wanna do some testing, understand the reliability of the light itself, and not really dive into it any further. And again, those are choices. That doesn't mean they're right or absolute, but those are choices I make by looking at the risk. And the reason I'm kind of going that way is to kind of introduce different concepts. So once I get down to the, let's say the controller, I could go through that and just to bring in prediction analysis, do a prediction analysis on that controller. I could do a Belcore or Telcordia or whatever I choose to do on that and come up with a model. So in this case, I could take the LED controller and I'm gonna go ahead and do a Telcordia, say, type of an analysis, go through it, and at the end, once I've done all of that, what am I gonna get? I'm gonna end up coming with a generating failure rate. Let's say I've done my derating, whatever else I wanna do on that. And once I'm done with it, I have a model that I can again publish, just like I would do a Weibull analysis. So I'll go ahead and publish that. And once I've published that, I can go back in and point this one to that analysis. The reason I'm doing that is just to bring another, what I would call a spoke activity, bring it into the center. And in this case, I'm using prediction to do it. That's another activity that will provide a model. Or maybe I'm choosing to do something else. And in the case of the LED light, what I wanna be doing now is I wanna understand the reliability of that. So my choice may be to go ahead and do an accelerated degradation type of an analysis on it. Basically, you wanna put in additional stresses on it so you do it faster. And at the same time, I'm not gonna wait till it fails. I'm gonna find a characteristic of interest and look at how that degrades over time. In this case, for this, I'm gonna look at lumens. So what I could do is go through that and run, let's say, a voltage type of a test, increase the voltage on it, look at lumens as my output measurement, and go through and do my degradation analysis. Once I'm done with my accelerated degradation analysis, really what I do at the end is again create that object model. Make sense? So I can go through that, and after I've done with all the steps I need to go through, I'll just say, okay, that's my end result. Let's go build an object model now. And once I've built that, that now describes the reliability of the LED lamp. So once I've done that, really in effect what I just did is I said, well, at this point, for the controller, I'm gonna have somebody do some type of prediction analysis, and I'm gonna package that and point it to here. For the LED bulb, I've done an accelerated degradation test. Again, that's another activity out on the spokes. Have somebody package that and point it over here. The minute I've done that, everything got revised again. Now, if while I'm doing that test, I found out there is more things I need to know on that bulb because I'm doing the accelerated test, and there may be other failure modes I haven't considered, or I got more information, guess what? That goes back in there, I start looking at those. So everything I learn, I add back in, and I go through the same process.